People who are into supply chain, people who are into logistics, would be the people who are basically the stakeholders to this issue. Apart from that, finance is a big stakeholder, because there will be an impact on cash flow, there will be an impact on P&L, the profit and loss account, there would be an impact on how we handle the compliance around GST, that is filing, registrations and all other aspects. There will be an impact on how we manage the supply chain, that is where are the warehouses, where are the godowns, where are the depots, where are the CNF agents and whatnot. So in the GST scenario, whether there will be a exemption on branch transfer as it is currently, whether there will be forms like C form, H form, F form, what will happen to them, what will happen to the return filing, how will the periodicity around return filing be there in GST, what will be impact on specific industries like manufacturing, dyes and chemicals, food ingredients, logistics, how will the scenario change. So there are e-commerce and various other new age businesses like aggregation and stuff like that, how will they impact. So lot of discussions and issues are going on off the lobby, on the lobby around this topic, and we at APMH felt that it is worth making people understand and help them get the maximum benefit of the situation instead of keeping on worrying around the situation. Or another thing is listening to people here and there and taking judgments, like someone is saying that in GST you will not get the credit of this, that, or whether it is around what will be the warehousing impact of GST. Lot of discussions are going on. So we thought that it will be a good idea for the industry and the trade to come together and discuss on this topic and come to conclusion as to how this will impact your specific scenario and how this will change the way of life in the industry. And it is called as the biggest tax reform that India is passing through in these another 60-70 years of time. And you would have heard that the constitutional amendment bill had to be passed just for the sake of bringing GST in the framework, because the services were in the prerogative of the center and the goods were in the prerogative of the state. So how this will change and why the constitutional amendment had to be brought and the Lok Sabha had to be moved just for the sake of changing the GST, right? So it will be a major benefit to people who are ahead of learning curve, that is before time as far as this is concerned. We have a lot of clients in various big corporates where we have seen that they have already finished the trainings, already finished the discussions, already established the structures, already calculated the impact of GST. There is another strata of people who are like industries in these belts who are yet to get into that process and start the analysis and do the needful for GST. You would have been aware about the transition roadmap that is already fixed and the migration of the vendors or dealers from VAT to GST has already started, and that will maybe many of us would have already taken the registrations or are in the process of taking the registrations, and the portal is already on. We have already started getting a lot of registrations for our clients. So we feel that it is a perfect time for this strata of industry to understand and analyze the impact, especially the senior level team members, including finance professionals, supply chain and others, and also the CEOs if any. So I welcome you all for this ahead of curve learning of GST, and I respect you all a lot because you are interested and wanting to know ki kya hone wala hai, how it is going to change the scenario, and you are all interested and keen to be ahead of others in the industry to the extent of understanding, implementing this reform. Okay. So APMH has an office in Roha for a while, 2012 onwards, and we have an office at Vidyavihar as well. So one of our partners, Mr. CA Pranav Kapadia, is here. He's been in this field of indirect tax for almost 15 years in practice, and he's been focusing on VAT, that is the value added tax, and the service tax per se, and that has made him automatically learn and understand GST before all of us have started understanding and learning. Another thing is he's been connected to the sales tax practitioners association for a while, that is almost more than 4-5 years, and from office bearer he's been now the vice president of the sales tax practitioner association of Maharashtra. So he is involved in the transition process from the government end as well, because he is part of the department, VAT department, and the commissioners, he understands them and knows them very well. So it will be of advantage not only from the theoretical perspective but as well as practical perspective as to how this whole thing will work and what will be the impact on me and you as far as GST is concerned. So with these few words, I think I would come to the subject proper, that is GST impact, and start the presentation on the topic. The flow will be as follows. We will have him for another 1.5 hours, and then we can have say 1/2 hour of question answers, wherein you all seniors can ask questions around GST, and you can enhance your understanding or get specific inputs about your industry as to how it will change. Yeah, aap logon ko hindi mein baat karna theek lagega ya marathi mein, marathi to hum log zyada kar nahi payenge, english mein theek lagega, ye dono mein se, what is the comfort on language, how many are comfortable on english and hindi, because the point is ultimately the thing has to be understood. ठीक है, खाली वो भाषण देने की बात नहीं है, आपको समझ में आनी चाहिए. तो कैन आई हैव अ रेज ऑफ हैंड्स एज फार एज हाउ मेनी आर कीन टू लिसन इट इन हिंदी, एंड कुछ बता सकते हैं कितने लोगों को हिंदी में आसानी होगी समझने को? इंग्लिश इज गुड फॉर मैक्सिमम, देन वी कैन डू इट इन इंग्लिश इटसेल्फ. It will be comfortable for him and everyone. Okay, so that's the introduction. We can start. Pranav, I can take over.
Idhar alag hi hai, idhar questions pe. Good morning, all of you. Well, GST aa raha hai karke, it's almost round the corner, and we all are sensing that GST is really coming in. Except for this demonetization effect, whether it would have a effect on whether GST would really get implemented the way things are happening since the last 2 days in the assembly, except for that, if we see the journey of GST, well, it had a slow pace earlier. It all started in 2004 when it was first moved that okay, GST would come from 2010, but then by the time the model draft law and everything got implemented, it was in 2015. May 2015 was the time when GST, the first process for GST actually came up, and the 122nd constitutional amendment bill was brought in the Lok Sabha. And then it had a long journey. The basic was that it required a majority in both the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. Lok Sabha, the numbers were there with the BJP government. Rajya Sabha, you all know the numbers were short. But and ultimately, in August 2016, after a gap of almost 13 months, it was passed in the Rajya Sabha. Now, what has been passed in the Rajya Sabha is the Constitution Amendment Bill. As Mitesh Bhai rightly told us, that the government, the state government, has the power to levy tax on goods, and the central government has the power to levy tax on services. The state government does not have power to levy tax on services, and hence these constitutional powers were required between the state and the center, that both should be able to tax both the goods as well as the services. Of course, the central government had the power to tax on manufacturing, that is the excise that we are paying to the central government. But these powers were not there. And to bring in GST, this constitutional amendment was a basic necessity. Unless and until the constitution is amended, GST cannot be brought in. So it all started with the first step. Then, and see the pace. Now, we started with 2004, 2010. If you see from August 2016, the pace of what GST has taken up, the amendments got approved in Lok Sabha on 8th of August, within 5 days of the approval from Rajya Sabha. Then an endorsement was required by 50% of the state assemblies. Ek state assembly bulana hai to it's such a big, ek meeting bulana hai to 50 logo ko ikatta, 10 logo ko bhi ikatta karna to kitna mushkil hota hai, apna office mein bhi. Haan, so 50%, so around 15 or 16 states were required to call their assemblies and pass this Constitution Amendment Bill, which got cleared in the next 15 days. 15 states cleared it in the next 15 days. Then the President's assent was required for that amendment. That happened immediately. And then what we now have finally is the 101st Constitution Amendment Act, which is passed on 8th of September 2016. Still after that, there was the formation of the GST Council, because it is the GST Council who will recommend the GST law to the government, and based on their recommendations, the final law will be enacted. So for that also the government had 60 days, but it got formed within 4 or 5 days. Within 4 days the GST Council was formed after that. Then, now still the recommendations which will be given by the GST Council, they will have to be ratified by the respective central and state governments again. So there is still one more step which is happening. The winter session is there, and in this winter session the model GST law has to be presented with the various amendments that are proposed in the model GST law, and that has to still get approved. And drafting of central and state GST acts and rules, and then the final effective date will be announced by the GST Council. There is one person behind this all, and that is Mr. Narendra Modi. He has told that we want it from 1st of April 2017, and that is how the entire process, it's a very big cycle. If we understand how this demonetization decision has been taken, we can understand, yes, the GST, if a decision is taken, it will get implemented. Numbers game is still there, a little numbers game here and there to get it passed in the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. But the way things are happening and the way things are moving, the speed is really super fast. Now, these are some of the important timelines which have been highlighted by the Revenue Secretary, Mr. Hasmukh Adhiya. Now, what he has told, I think this all has already happened. What remains now is establishing the GSTN network, and each of the states will have to enable their IT network also. So that process has started. The GSTN portal has come into effect, and the GST registrations state-wise, they have given the respective dates, that so-and-so states, Western region, Northern region, Southern region, they have given the dates, and the GST registration process has already commenced to get people familiar with the GST portal. So that process has begun. The testing of the software will go live from January 2017, and the outreach program by the government will begin in March 2017 to educate the people at large all across India, because it's not going to be only a few companies or a few people who are going to get affected. It's going to be entire India. Mere 125 crore deshvasiyo, I think that is his, he has to educate all of them that the GST is going to come in. So that is going to be a big step. Now, what happened when the bill went to Rajya Sabha? Did all the constitutional amendments take place, or still something remained? two or three things got passed in the Rajya Sabha, two or three things still remain. Now what were that? Biggest question was compensation to the states. It is always the finance and the power. Who will have the finance, who will have the power? And that was the fight that was happening. Ultimately, the central government agreed that for 5 years, compensation shall be provided for a period of 5 years. So now the states are at peace. Okay, 5 years tak jo bhi revenue loss state ko hoga because of GST, that they are going to get compensated. And in this context, you might be knowing that recently Maharashtra government, they announced the rate of VAT, right? It got announced from 5.5 to 6%. All of a sudden, 16th September, they just announced that from 17th September, the rate gets announced from 5.5 to 6, from 12.5 to 13.5%. And not only Maharashtra, other states have also done that and are still doing. So this is all the game for compensation and the revenue, that each state government wants to have their share. Then there was one more proposal in the earlier constitution amendment bill to levy 1% additional levy on interstate supply of goods. Now what was that? What was that? Today we are having CST. You might be knowing, those who are having interstate transactions, when we sell goods against C form, we charge 2% CST. So that 2% CST, although it is collected by the state, but the share has to go, that 2% goes to the state. Although it is levied by the center, it is a central sales tax, but the states get it. Now, if under GST, we are speaking of a seamless flow of credit, then this 1% additional rate of tax, then this 1% additional rate of tax should not have been levied, and rightly so. A very good thing which happened, that this additional 1%, because this 1% was applicable for all interstate transactions that would happen, and it was non-creditable. So this thing has got scrapped in the Rajya Sabha. And establishing a mechanism for adjudicating dispute between the center and the state and between the states. So abhi bhi lagta hai ki kuch na kuch jhagda to chalne hi wala hai. And for that they wanted a mechanism, and which the amendment bill has made provision for, that there will be a mechanism to settle interstate disputes and disputes between the center and the state governments. These two things have still not been approved in the Rajya Sabha. Cap on the GST rates. They wanted that the GST rates should get fixed. There should be an upper limit on the rate of GST to be applicable, and which should come in the Constitution Amendment Bill. But that has not come, and accordingly rightly so, because we never know what is going to be the impact of GST on our economy. If we have to make a single amendment in the Constitution, these are the processes that the government has to go through to make a single amendment in the Constitution. And if say they want to increase the rate from 18% to 19%, then all these processes would have to be done. And I think, so what would be done? So these powers would be given under the respective GST law, and there the recommendations would come from the GST council, and based on those recommendations the rates of GST would be given in the law itself and not in the Constitution, and rightly so. So this good thing has happened, that this has not come. The demand of the opposition was there that this cap should come, but this has not come. And one more was regarding adjudication of SSCs having turnover below rupees 1.5 crores by the states is not considered. And this is the issue which is being debated today also. If you see, you might have read in the news or somewhere, that once the GST Council was established, some decisions were taken. One decision which is still pending, and for which already they have had two formal meetings and one informal meeting with all the states, state commissioners and all the state leaders, is regarding this adjudication. And even today, right today on 23rd of September, the sales tax department staff is on strike against GST. Right? So this is the, and this is happening in every state. This is happening in every state, that who will adjudicate the SSCs? Who will have the powers to assess the SSCs? The basic question is, abhi kya ho raha, what is happening now? We have an excise registration number, we have a VAT registration number, we have a service tax registration number. And for that, we are having three separate returns, three separate assessing officers, three separate assessments. Everything is separate. One taxation department team pura ek din wohi kaam kar raha hai. Right? Now, do we still want to continue this under GST? Or what we are thinking, what GST is kya? One nation, one tax. वन नेशन वन टैक्स है तो फिर टैक्स रेट भी एक होना चाहिए, एसेसिंग ऑफिसर भी एक होना चाहिए. बट आई थिंक दिस इज स्टिल द गेम ऑफ पावर. द स्टेट इज स्टिल नॉट रेडी टू गो टू लीव इट्स पावर. द सेंट्रल वॉन्ट्स टू कीप इट्स पावर. And this tussle is still on. And on 23rd and 24th, today and tomorrow are the two major meetings for this decision, which is pending with the GST Council. So let's hope for the best that good sense prevails on them, that there should be only one assessing officer. I think that is what we all want, because there is no point in having multiple assessments across the board. So let's hope that good sense prevails on them. This is the existing tax structure in India. You all are aware of it. On one side we have the direct tax, on the other side we have indirect taxes. On the direct tax front we have income tax and wealth tax, but wealth tax has since been abolished in 2015-16. On the indirect tax side we have central taxes and state taxes. In central we have excise, service tax and customs. And on the state side we have VAT and CST and other levies like entry tax, luxury tax, lottery tax, etc. So this is our existing structure. Now what is going to happen? These central taxes are going to get subsumed under GST. So central excise duty will get subsumed. Additional duty of customs, which is levied by the customs department, will get subsumed. Special additional duties of customs, that SAD 4%, many people are claiming a refund out of that SAD once if they prove that these goods are further sold in the course of their business. So that SAD refund is available, but it is not available across the board. It is available to only those who can prove it. Service tax is getting subsumed. Central sales tax is getting subsumed. The central surcharges and cesses like the Krishi Kalyan cess, the Swachh Bharat cess, they will also get subsumed. And excise duty on medicinal and toiletries preparation act, a small act applicable to a few specified entities. But these are the taxes which will get subsumed under GST. These are the central taxes. And the state taxes which will get subsumed are VAT or sales tax, as we call in general, because each state is having their own VAT law. The state level entry tax, this is a big concern for all the people, because there are so many entry tax barriers, way bills, paying entry tax on entry of goods into the other states. I think this is a big trouble for the entire industry, and this is going to get subsumed into GST. So this will be a good advantage for the business community at last. Purchase tax will get subsumed now, although after onset of VAT there are very few items, especially in Maharashtra it is purchase tax on sugarcane. That act is still there. So that would get subsumed under GST, and for a few specified commodities like cotton, yarn and all those items, there is a purchase tax applicable in a few circumstances. So those would get subsumed. State surcharges and cesses, if any. Entertainment tax, luxury tax and taxes on lottery, betting and gambling. So now all these taxes will go and they all will get subsumed into the GST. We can take up questions if you have any questions in your mind while we are deciding. I think we can make the session interactive. It's not a lecture meeting. I think we all are learning, because I'm also still learning this new law. It is new for all of us. Only thing is that we have to unlearn what we have learned over all these years and make a fresh beginning. We are on a clean slate and learn new things. So we can make it an interactive session. So what remains? GST आने के बाद भी कौन सा tax रहने वाला है? We saw what is getting subsumed under central, what is getting subsumed under the state taxes. So what remains? The basic customs duty. See, we saw in the earlier slide that additional duties of customs and special additional duties of custom, although they are levied under the Customs Act, those two are getting subsumed. But the basic customs duty for import of goods into the country, the basic customs duty will remain at its place. Stamp duty, which is generally levied on immovable property, because immovable property are not goods, the tax cannot be levied on immovable property. Although for under construction property, because of the various judgments, they are levying VAT and sales tax, service tax on it. But stamp duty per se, since being an immovable property, it is still outside the purview of GST, except the renting part of that immovable property. So stamp duty would still continue on the immovable property. Tax on alcoholic liquor for human consumption. This is generally levied by the state, and the states would continue to tax the alcoholic liquor for human consumption. Petroleum products, I think this is one big thing. Petroleum products are still not getting covered under GST. So what would happen? For these products, VAT Act would continue. Excise would continue, if any leviable on those products. And this is the biggest source of revenue to the government. If we take Maharashtra state for example, if the collection 2015-16, the VAT collection in the state of Maharashtra was around 65,000 crores, out of which almost 30,000 crores comes from petroleum products, companies like IOCL, BPCL, the companies which, and there is a major chunk which still remains with the state. The revenue of that is going to be with the states. And most important, the companies, the manufacturing companies who are going to purchase the petroleum products from these companies, they are not going to get set off under GST. Wo to VAT lagane wala hai. They are not going to charge GST on that. So that impact is going to be a big impact. The major cost for the companies where these products are being used in their manufacturing processes or some other processes. I think that is one area which is still to be subsumed under GST, although they have mentioned in their announcements that it will be made effective at a future date. So it is not that they will be always be out of the GST net, but maybe the government wants time to bring it into the GST arena. And tax on entertainment and amusement levied and collected by municipal authority. In the earlier slide also, you must have seen that I have mentioned entry tax and entertainment tax. So if the entry tax, entertainment tax is levied by the state authorities, it will get subsumed. But wherein it is levied by the local municipal authorities, the local authorities, those are not getting subsumed. So immediately the next question which comes to our mind is, what happens to octroi and LBT? Rahega ki jayega? Because again it's a big cost for the companies wherever LBT is applicable. Although the limit now has been made 50 crores qua each branch where it is there, or each location, or each municipal area for LBT. But according to me, and based on certain information, that because in one of the meetings where we were with the state finance minister Sudhir Mungatiwarji, where various trade associations had come and they have demanded that LBT and octroi should get subsumed and it should not continue under the GST, and there he has promised that LBT and octroi would get subsumed under GST and it would not be levied separately. So that is the only ray of hope, that LBT wouldn't remain based on the assurances given by the state finance minister. But again, it has to be ultimately cleared at the Lok Sabha level. In the main act, it has to get covered. But it appears that mostly it will not be levied. They say that LBT and octroi, although levied by the municipal authorities, it accrues to the state, and that is why there is a possibility that LBT and octroi would get subsumed under the GST. So what should ideally GST be? We are telling one nation, one tax. So it should ideally be a singular tax on all supplies with a uniform rate and seamless credit. This is a perfect situation that we are all wishing for. But will it actually come? Let's see. Considering the federal structure of India, the Empowered Committee has worked out the dual model of GST. The central government will levy central GST, which is CGST. The state government will levy state GST, that is SGST. Supplies imported into the country will be liable for GST. Customs duty is not being subsumed, but the other two duties which we saw, the additional duties of customs and the special additional duties of customs, SAD. So possibly what would happen, that GST would be levied on in lieu of those two taxes, SAD and additional customs duty of customs, by way of IGST it would be levied, and possibly it will come under the reverse charge mechanism. Now that things are yet to be formulated by the government, how it is going to actually come, but that is what is being proposed. And supplies exported from the countries will be zeroed. Today also all exports are zeroed. There is no tax on export of goods, so that would continue. interstate supplies, including branch transfers, imports and exports, will be governed by integrated GST, that is the IGST, which would consist of two components, CGST and SGST. I have taken examples, we will come to those examples of how the workings would be. This is the model which the government has formed for their internal controls and for their collection, levy and distribution. CGST will be held by the central government and SGST will be transferred to the destination state government. GST being a destination based consumption tax. So whatever SGST is being levied, that would go to the state where the goods are actually finally consumed by the purchaser of those goods. IGST will enable the smooth flow of credits between the origin and destination states, because what is going to happen that for all interstate supplies, IGST would be levied and IGST will accrue to the central government. Out of that, it will be an internal mechanism of the central and state government of distribution of CGST and SGST. Maybe we as users of the GST Act or we as the users of this GST system, maybe we are not directly concerned at how that would happen. It is going to be a matter for the internal control and distribution of CGST and SGST. The tax on interstate supplies to the destination states, this we have taken up. Right, so this will be the new structure now. Tax structure, direct tax, only income tax remains. Wealth tax, as we saw in the earlier slide, wealth tax has gone. In indirect tax, there will be only GST, except customs. For intrastate transactions, means transactions within the state, we will have CGST and SGST, and for interstate transactions we will have IGST. Just to depict this with an example, this side we have India and this side we have say the other world. In that, this is Maharashtra, out of Maharashtra, and this is the outside world. Yeah, so this we are here placed at Roha, you are over here. You are making a go back. First of all, say you are making a local purchase within Roha, within from Maharashtra you are buying. So what would be charged to you? It will be a local purchase for you, and you and the person will charge you SGST plus CGST. Say for example, let's take an example that the rate of GST is say 18%. So 9% SGST and 9% CGST would be levied by the person. Next. For interstate purchases that we will be making, say you are purchasing goods from Gujarat. So the person who is selling from Gujarat will charge IGST in the invoices that he will raise to your company at Roha. Next. In case of imports, say you are importing from another country, so what would be levied on your purchases? Basic customs duty would be there on imports plus IGST. Now this IGST would be by way of reverse charge mechanism. We are already having reverse charge mechanism for service tax. For those companies who are already registered as service tax and they are importing services, they are already paying tax under reverse charge mechanism for services. There was no reverse charge mechanism for goods per se. So now reverse charge mechanism will come. In this situation, it is definitely going to come for import purchases. Next. Say now you are making a branch transfer within the state. Say from Roha, you are having a godown at Bhiwandi and you are making a branch transfer. There will be no tax on branch transfer. Now this is going to be a deviation for the companies who are registered under excise. For those under VAT, those who have only VAT, now you might be knowing the differences. Are you charging any excise when you are transferring the goods from one location to another location? Yes. So now that will be the big change that will happen. There will be no tax on transfer of goods within Maharashtra. Are you charging VAT on those transactions? You are not charging. So this is the combination now of excise and VAT. Abhi the play is coming, and we saw a part of service tax reverse charge also coming in. So what the government is trying to do is trying to compromise all the three acts. These are three major acts which are applicable, and trying to bring in the features of all the three into one single thing. So this will be the big change, that because now what is happening for excise, for each location you are having a separate excise registration number, you are filing separate excise returns for each location, or you are filing one combined, each location there is a separate return. Right, so I think here there will be a relief to the industry as such, because tax will not be leviable. Right, next. I think those photographs and the pictures are not coming.
Even here they are not. But in the notes there are the pictures.
Yeah. No problem.
See that.
Actually there's a picture of a truck over here, there's a picture of a godown over here, but I don't know, there's some technical. So now when your material is at Bhiwandi and you are selling it to Mumbai locally, so here you will charge SGST and CGST when you are selling locally. So there will be one type of transaction which is happening locally. Next.
Within Maharashtra.
Again, that is why we have made this bifurcation outside Maharashtra and outside India. Branch transfer, interstate branch transfer. Say you are having a branch at Baroda, right? So when you are making a transfer from Roha to Baroda branch, so IGST would be charged on that. So now let's compare again with the existing scenario. What we are doing? Are we charging excise for the interstate branch transfer? Yes. Are we charging any VAT? No VAT. Why? It's a branch transfer against
F-form.
Against F-form. Yeah, so that is again going to be a big, big change. So many branch transfers are happening between the various locations of the company itself, or with their consignment agents in the other states. Right, so all those branch transfers will now become fully taxable. And IGST, say in our example, we have taken the rate of 18%. So at present, maybe we are paying that excise component in Maharashtra and taking the credit while moving the goods from year to year. We are taking the credit of that? In the other state, we are getting the credit, or are we not getting? We are getting the credit, right? So what would happen in, so that excise credit anyways you are getting, that excise was getting blocked into that for the interstate branch transfers, but VAT or CST was not payable. So now that would also become payable. Right, so there will be a more inflow of funds, or rather outflow of funds for the company in their branch transfers, and that money would get blocked to that extent with the government. They have to plan their resources. Okay, Mumbai say from Roha to Baroda if I am sending, then I'll get an IGST over there. So what will happen to the IGST? How to claim the credit? Because for CST there is no credit. Interstate purchases CST 2% lag gaya to credit nahi, C form diya to bhi there is no credit for CST. But IGST full credit will be available, because it is accruing to the destination.
But then you know, hassle of maintaining the bonds and all this.
Yeah, that hassle will go away, and oh, that's a big, big relief.
That relief.
Yes, that is
but
going
to
be. Yes. Apne ko usse paisa bhi lena hai, form bhi lena hai. Hame uske andar hai. Right, so that is going to be a big relief for the
branch transfer only outside the state. It is IGST, but within the state where we are transferring any stocks, there is no tax.
There is no tax on that.
But if there is 100% stock transfer, then that factory will get equal credit. What will you do with it?
So that is what is to be planned now. So whether do we want to do a branch transfer? Is it a necessity to do a branch transfer, or do we need to replan our schedules, our locations, our warehouses, and make an directly a interstate sale? Because abhi samne wale credit pura milne wala hai across the chain. So I think that will have to be worked out, that impact. I think that is what all the companies, we have already started doing that impact analysis for the companies, that what should they do, how much funds are getting blocked because of this excise and VAT as of today, and what would happen in the GST scenario. I think that is one impact analysis which every company will have to undergo to take a decision that whether the same system has to continue or some logistic changes are required in the working of the companies. We are hearing in so many places that central India is becoming a big hub per company. So many companies are setting up their godowns, warehouses in central India. Right? So maybe for our case, what is applicable to our company? What are our logistics? Who are our customers? How are they going to get the credit? Based on so many variants and so many situations, a decision would have to be taken by the company management that what they want to do.
What will be the case where the subcontracting laws is being outside of Maharashtra?
Hmm.
Suppose my client is at Baroda, I am giving him the job work. He processes the work and returns it back to me.
Hmm.
So what will be the impact of the IGST in sending the material and returning back to him?
Right. So for job work transactions, so I understand your job work transitions are such that they are doing pure labor work. It is not a works contract. It is a pure labor that they are doing. You are supplying your excise paid material to them. They are doing some processing or labor work and they are sending back the material to you. Right? So that job work situation would still continue. That job worker has to be a registered dealer. If it's not a registered dealer, then you will have to pay IGST on the goods that are being transferred. Because how to keep the control of that? Right, so if that job worker is a registered job worker, you can transfer the goods to the job worker, and if the goods come back within 6 months, again the time period, because even under current excise laws also those limits are there. So that provisions are continuing under the GST law. And there are again conditions for transferring of capital assets also to those branches, to such branches, and for that a time frame of 2 years has been kept, that if they are not returned back within 2 years, then the input credit would get reversed, whatever input credit is there.
IGST will attract or?
IGST, if you are sending it to a registered branch in the other state, then IGST will not be retracted.
Not our branch.
No, the job worker. The job worker. Job worker. Then IGST would not get attracted.
That means, will that form continue when we are sending the material for goods for processing outside? We are currently using even form. So will that continue?
No, even is not for job processing.
Under excise,
huh?
Yeah. Under excise, when you're sending for processing, will that form continue?
Some systems will be there, because I think the GSTN portal will be a transaction-wise details will have to be uploaded in the system, and your transactions will have to be mentioned. There will be a coding system for each type of transactions. If you are having that coding system, it will go through the border check also, post also. If you show that number, it will get across through that. So all those systems are being developed. We'll have to see how those systems are actually coming up. Those systems are still in the pipeline. They have given a brief outline of how the systems would be.
It is not clear yet.
No. See, let's understand one more thing. I should clarify that also. Because what we are studying today is the model GST draft law, which we are having in the domain. We are having the model GST draft law in the domain. The basic crux of what is going to come would generally remain the same. The procedures regarding the forms, formats, some of those procedures have been released by the government, some rules have come out by the government, the draft rules, the draft formats, the registration rules, the registration formats, those things have come. But still, and those were released in the month of June 2016, the model GST draft law had come in June 2016. And after that, various suggestions have gone from various associations, professional associations as well as trade associations. That there are various suggestions which have gone to the government, and based on that the final draft law would come in public domain again. Now only thing that we are recently hearing is that the second draft model law that is going to come, either it will go, it may come in the public domain if time permits. If time does not permit and if they want to stick to the 1st April deadline, and again depends on how the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha are functioning, demonetization effect and all those, they may directly place it before the parliament and that may come out directly, and then whatever changes are required, those changes hote rahenge, let the law get implemented. So I think that is what we are hearing from the sources in the GST department. So what we are having is the model draft GST law, but I think from what we read, almost 80% of the law which is there, that things would be there, the basic structure, all that, this basic overview that we are looking at today, those things would be there. Maybe the procedural parts that ki wo particular form even ki jagah pe kya aega, maybe that procedures will have to be given by the government. And in the draft law also, they have at least at more than 150 places it is says as will be prescribed. So So all those rules, etc., would still come in. That what is the exact procedure for sending the goods, the exact procedure for getting back the goods. But the basic provision is there. You can send it to your job worker, he is registered, aapko tax nahi bharna hai. There are also provisions that you can even directly also send the goods to the job worker, as you are doing it today also. So those provisions have also been taken care of. There are provisions for transitional changes, that what would happen to the year-end excise credit or year-end service tax credit that we are having, or VAT credit that we are having. So those provisions, there are almost a 200 pages model draft law is there. Vitesh, you have the book?
Yeah.
So this is the book which has been formed by our association. I was instrumental in bringing out this booklet, which contains the model draft GST law. There are FAQs which have been given by the Central Board of Excise and Customs. So all those things have come into play, but still we are yet to get the final law. So whatever we are studying today is based on this. Yeah.
Like I have told a group to interstate
leader,
he returns the taxes. What will happen to IGST?
Yes. Yeah, so I think then.
State.
Yeah. So he will have to charge you IGST again.
Okay.
Yes. He will have to charge you.
If the job worker is not registered, then my registration myself, whether I have to defer the job worker's additional paisa business?
Yes. Yes, that provision is also there. That provision is also there. If the job worker is not registered, you can add that job worker as an additional place of business, and then the transfer will be allowed. So ultimately, the purpose is to keep track of the goods, that the goods are moving from one state to another or from one location to another, and that tracking is required.
This is louder. Yeah, we go ahead. Yeah, so once having, we were on this slide over here, IGST, after making a branch transfer to Baroda, and the person sells locally from Baroda to Ahmedabad, then he will apply the local SGST of that state. One more thing which we need to understand is how this law is going to come. Whether it will be one single act, because today we have the Central Excise Act 1944, we have the Central Excise rules, and there are various rules. We have the service tax which is governed by the Finance Act 1994, and there are various rules under the service tax rules. Then we have the VAT law of each respective state and the VAT rules applicable for each state. We have the Central Sales Tax Act, the Central Sales Tax Registration and Turnover rules which are applicable to all of India, and the Central Sales Tax Bombay rules, Central Sales Tax Gujarat rules, all those rules are there. So there are so many rules and regulations which are applicable as of today. So now how will the rules and the law and the rules come under GST? एक सिंगल एक्ट होगा तो अच्छा है, सबके लिए रिलीफ है, बट एक्चुअली दैट इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी द केस. वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ सेपरेट आईजीएसटी लॉ, अ सेपरेट सीजीएसटी लॉ, एंड स्टेट वाइज जीएसटी लॉज. सो अगेन वी विल बी हैविंग 31 स्टेट जीएसटी लॉज टू बी एडमिनिस्टर्ड, विच विल बी एडमिनिस्टर्ड. सो दैट इज हाउ द लॉज आर गोइंग टू बी. अगेन these laws are going to be administered by the respective states separately. So it will be a separate filing of returns for each of the states separately. But only beneficial factor is that the things will be much more standardized now, because they have made a common portal, a common model law which will be applicable to all the states. If we see the current, suppose if we want to compare excise law, service tax law and VAT law, we have to read, understand and study all the three separately. But now with this, all the three GSTs, IGST, CGST and SGST coming under one roof, at least we need to study the SGST applicable to that state and CGST and IGST law. We will not have to read so many different laws which are applicable as of now. Right, so that is one advantage, although I understand that it would have been still better that only one law would have been made applicable all across India. It would have been much better and easier. But things as they are today, the government, the dual structure that we talked of. Somebody told me that when the Empowered Committee's meeting was going on at Delhi, there was an issue regarding what rate of tax should be levied for Navwari sarees. So somebody from Maharashtra told that there should be no tax on Navwari sarees. This is the traditional dress of Maharashtra women, so it should not be there. So immediately, Kanchipuram saree ka kya hoga? The other state thing. So this is the fight that is still going on. What will the rate of taxes applicable? Because the local conditions are always required to be met and fulfilled by the politicians and the states. So those factors are still going to play their role, and they are already playing their roles. And that is why we are having a dual structure under GST. So basically, apart from a few rates, generally the rate of tax would be same across all commodities across India. Except for a few items, only the powers will be given to the state. But I think what they are planning is they will be having a uniform rate structure for all commodities across India. Because today, if we see Maharashtra, it was 12.5, the rate enhanced to 13.5. In Gujarat, it was already 15%. Since last 2 years, it is 15%. In other states, it was already 14.5 or 15% in other states. So, at least for a particular commodity, the rate of tax would remain the same all across India. Bearing a few local commodities which may be exempted. So the rate of tax will be same, and that is why the market, they are telling that there is one nation, one tax, one market. So from wherever you buy the material, you are going to get the same rate of tax applicable. Aaj main Gujarat se purchase karta hu to mujhe 15% bharna pad raha hai, Maharashtra se 12.5 tha, abhi 13.5 ho gaya. So that difference is always a big cost to the companies, and especially if they are not able to get the credit of it. Some cases, the manufacturing companies generally get the input tax credit or whatever they use in manufacturing. But there are various traders, organizations, so many people, they are not getting the credit. So the credit flow will become much easier in that scenario. One more aspect which we need to understand while discussing is this, that what is going to be the threshold limit under the GST Act? See, as of now we know for a VAT registration, it is 10 lakhs per state. For a service tax registration, it is 10 lakhs of providing of services. And for an excise dealer, 1.5 crore is the limit, below which there is an SSI exemption, so those dealers are not required to pay excise. Now, what is the proposed limit under the GST? This was the first decision which was taken by the GST Council on 24th October, after it was formed, that the threshold limit would be 20 lakh rupees for all the dealers. So what would happen? All the manufacturers who are below 1.5 crores, they will become liable to GST at the rate of 18%, which they are, as of now, they are not paying excise, they are paying only VAT. Now you can try to see the impact that is going to come. Now this impact will start. Say, if that small manufacturer below 1.5 crores, if he buys from a dealer who is registered under GST, as of today, if that small dealer, if he is buying excisable goods, he is not getting the excise credit. He is not able to pass on the excise credit except if he is registered as a under Rule 57F as a dealer who can pass a first stage dealer, second stage dealer, except and very few of them are registered, not many are registered. So that credit they are not being able to pass on today, and hence the cost of those goods is getting enhanced, right? But once GST comes in, all these dealers will be liable to pay GST. They will get the sale VAT credit, and they will be able to pass on the sale VAT credit to their customers. And that is going to be a big impact. Or because there are, see, what I got to understand is there are around only 5 to 6 lakhs companies which are registered under excise in India. There are around 60 lakh dealers who are registered under VAT and 15 to 16 lakh dealers under service tax. And this is the quantum of registered dealers who are doing trade and business all across India. So around 80 lakhs is the total, which is a rough total which is coming. So very few persons are registered under excise. Now the tax base would get widened. This is one more point that we will be coming to. I'll speak on this again. But the impact that is going to come is the flow of input tax credit that would get enhanced. The coverage of the people who will be liable to pay GST would get enhanced, because all these people will now come under the GST net and they will be liable to pay GST. They will be eligible for the credit also. So both ways it is going to be a widening of the tax base for the government. So that's going to be a good thing. Now, coming to the input tax credit, ultimately मुझे मिलने क्या वाला है? मुझे मिलने वाला है input tax credit. कितना मिलेगा वो देखेंगे. But ultimately, what is the dealer going to get? We take a simple example. Say on my sales side, on my supply side, I have a liability of CGST. Against my CGST liability, I will get input tax credit of CGST paid on my purchases or on my inwards, and IGST, which is paid on my purchases. I will not get the SGST credit against CGST. Similarly, if I have a liability under SGST on my sales side, I am using the word sales quite loosely, because now the concept of sale is also going to change. Everything is going to be supplied. So manufacturer, see, excise is on manufacturer, manufacturer ka concept nikal jayega. VAT is on sales, I mean on sale of goods, the sale of goods, everything will be on supply of goods. Providing of services still remain, but you are supplying services. So everything will be a supply. So if the on my outward side I am liable to pay SGST, there is a SGST liability. Against that I will be able to take input tax credit of SGST paid on my purchases and IGST paid on my purchase. I will not get CGST. So only thing is the SGST and CGST cross tax credit is not allowed. If I were out on my liability side, outward liability is IGST, I will get credit of IGST, CGST and SGST. Right, so all the three would be available. If you see, IGST is common in all the three. So IGST credit is the king. IGST is the king now. So IGST credit is right for income tax depreciation. Depreciation is king. Kitna bhi hai, depreciation loss is always allowed to be carried forward. Business loss hai toh 8 saal ka limit hai. But depreciation, unabsorbed depreciation is allowed for lifetime. So aisa hai, IGST credit is allowed across the board, SGST and CGST credit is restricted. Let's take a basic example. Image is getting
the material.
No problem. So here, like we take an example.
They can look at the material also.
You have a material, yeah, it is there in the material. The example is there in the material which is given. Say you are a manufacturer, you have a purchase value of input of 100. There is a value addition when you are going to sell it of 30 rupees. So your sales value becomes 130 rupees. On the sales side, say if the rate is 15%, this is just an example which is taken, ad hoc figures, don't go by these rates. CGST say it is 10% and SGST say it is 5%. So the output CGST and output SGST, this would be the amounts that would be levied. Similarly, your input SGST, say this is 10% on 100 rupees, that would be directly available as credit. The SGST amount of here 5 rupees would come, that would also be available, and this would go as input to the wholesaler. Similar over here and similar to the retailer. We will come to one more example where it we are having some issues with the slide. Basically, if you see that example, what happened in the example, today what is happening, say if we are charging excise, say our material is excisable, on 100 rupees, say 12.5% is the excise, on 112.5 we are charging VAT of 12.5%. So 126 or 127 becomes the value. But what would happen under GST? The CGST and SGST both would get levied on 100 rupees only, and that cascading effect would get reduced, and that is going to be a big impact in the cost that is going to come for the companies. You may have to excuse me in case because I am having a sore throat, maybe after speech or whatever, it's taking its toll. If I have to sit down for 5 minutes, then Nitesh will continue from there, and I'll again re-continue after that. Yeah, so these are the GST effects. One nation, one tax. Basic threshold we have already seen, and we have seen the impact on the excise dealers also. 150 lakh small manufacturers, this limit has gone. The concept of supply of goods and services is there now. The tax is not on manufacturing, because whatever, say, disputes were there, that whether this is a manufacturer or this, it's not a manufacturer. So all those will have to be given a go by. We have to see the new scenario, whether this is a supply or it's not a supply. Supply has been defined separately. There are schedules which are given, the what will be considered as supply, what will not be considered as supply. So those things will have to again learn separately. Interstate branch transfers will become liable to GST, which till date, as we saw earlier, that because of F-form, interstate branch transfers were not liable, they will become liable to tax. Supplies to SEZ unit will become liable to GST. So again, that is one more issue, because today what is happening? Konsa form hai?
I.
Right, form I. Today we are transferring the goods to SEZ units against form I. So that form I will be done away with. Supply of services to SEZ unit, form A. Right, if we are registered with that SEZ unit, then there is a form A in which they incorporate us as a service provider. And when we are providing services to that SEZ unit, we need not charge tax to them. So both those things will be done away with, forms will go away, and supplies to SEZ would become chargeable. The SEZ will have to apply for refund to the government when they are exporting their supplies by way of supply of goods or by way of supply of services. So that change is going to come. Sales in transit. Kitne log karte hain sales in transit, even E2? Sab log kar rahe hain? Nahin kar rahe hain. Okay, so if you are not doing it, no problem. But this is one major area, sales in transit. Say when you are transferring material.
Can you highlight on this sales in transit?
Sales in transit. Okay. Sales in transit in the current scenario. I am speaking of the current scenario. What happens in the sales in transit? Say you are a company based in Maharashtra. You are buying goods from Gujarat and you want to sell goods in Karnataka. So what you can do, when you buy goods from Gujarat to Maharashtra, that seller in Gujarat will charge you CST 2% against C form. Okay? And you want to sell those goods to a person in Karnataka. What you can do, you can extract the person in Gujarat, then you directly send goods from Gujarat to Karnataka. Right? And how can that happen? Because see, ultimately cost is involved in this, logistics are involved in this, the transportation cost is the biggest cost, warehousing cost is another major cost. And the CST 2% is one more cost which is applicable to the company. So there is a provision that CST nil CST is charged when you make a sales in transit, like branch transfer. On branch transfer against F form, there is no tax, there is zero CST. Sales to SEZ against form I, there is zero CST. Similarly, when you are making a sales in transit, that is a subsequent sale in pursuance of a first sale. Once the movement of goods commences, and if during the movement of goods, the goods are sold by transfer of documents of title to the goods, that is what the section 62 of the CST Act says. If by transfer of title of documents of goods, if you are endorsing the LR and you tell that transporter, okay, you don't give the delivery at Mumbai, you give the delivery at Bangalore, and that becomes a sales in transit transaction. And as per section 6.2 of the CST Act, the first transaction which originates from where the movement of goods originates, that is from Gujarat to Mumbai. In our example, what is our example? We are at Mumbai, we are buying from Gujarat, we are selling to Bangalore, Karnataka, right? So when the person at Gujarat is selling to the person at Mumbai, he will charge CST 2%. When the person from Mumbai is selling to the person at Karnataka, during the movement of goods, then CST 0% will be charged against as sales in transit, and certain forms are to be exchanged. Now what are those forms? The person at Mumbai will issue C form to the person at Gujarat. The person in Bangalore will issue C form to the person at Mumbai, and the person at Gujarat will issue an even form to the person at Mumbai to ensure and to certify that these goods have been sold in transit to this person and delivery thereof has gone to the third person. So that is how the sales in transit takes place. Now this sales in transit concept would be given a go by. So what would happen under GST? Gujarat to Mumbai, IGST will be levied at full rate 18% instead of CST 2%. Mumbai to Bangalore again 18% will be levied. But the person at Mumbai will get the credit of that 18% which the person from Gujarat has charged to the person at Mumbai. So this is the basic translation. The only concept, this concept still continues. It is not that the concept, the way of doing business is not getting changed. The concept of that you can transfer your goods by endorsement of the LR, that concept still continues under the GST law also. Under the IGST law, under the place of supply, they have clearly mentioned that you can still transfer the goods by endorsing the LR. That concept still continues, but the rate of tax which was exempted earlier, that will now become taxable and credit would be available to the person buying the goods. And what we have seen is this is the major area where there is a litigation with the department. Forms. What happens in such cases? The government is not getting the forms. I mean, the dealer may get the form, but government is not getting any revenue. And hence they try to investigate more into this. अरे form सबसे पहले तो form आता नहीं है. Form आया तो defective आता है. LR proper नहीं है. So many points are there. Then in between there were this sales in transit, there were issues regarding that whether pre-existing orders would be allowed for a sales in transit or they would not be allowed. And after a lot of controversy now, after the judgment of Ajay Trading Company, it has been settled that pre-existing order hai, toh bhi sales in transit will be allowed. For F-form transaction again, if there is a pre-existing order, F-form transaction, in spite of producing the F-form, the transaction fails. Substance over form. Agar aapke आपका ब्रांच है बेंगलोर में और बेंगलोर ब्रांच ने आपको ऑर्डर दिया है, आपने एफ फॉर्म के अगेंस्ट में उनको सेल किया है, बट इफ द ऑफिसर कम्स टू दैट ओके द बेंगलोर ब्रांच आल्सो हैड अ ऑर्डर फ्रॉम समबडी इन बेंगलोर दैट दिस स्पेसिफिक गुड्स आर रिक्वायर्ड, दे आर डिसअलाउइंग द एंटायर एफ फॉर्म ट्रांजैक्शन इन स्पाइट ऑफ प्रोड्यूसिंग द एफ फॉर्म्स. इट इज सब्सटेंस ओवर फॉर्म बिकॉज सच अ ट्रांजैक्शंस आर नॉट अलाउड. यू कैन हैव अ स्टॉक एंड सेल ट्रांजैक्शन फॉर एफ फॉर्म, आपका वेयरहाउस में आप स्टॉक कर सकते हो, वहां से आप सेल कर सकते हो, लेकिन डायरेक्ट अगर किसी का ऑर्डर है अगेंस्ट एफ फॉर्म, दैट इज नॉट अलाउड. एंड वी आर फेसिंग सो मेनी सच केसेस इन लिटिगेशन इन ट्राइब्यूनल, महाराष्ट्र ट्राइब्यूनल रिसेंटली आल्सो, आई थिंक देयर आर क्रोज एंड क्रोज ऑफ लायबिलिटी कमिंग बिकॉज ऑफ ओनली ऑफ एफ फॉर्म ट्रांजैक्शंस एंड इवन इवेंट ट्रांजैक्शंस. सो वन थिंग इज गुड, एट लीस्ट दोस हैसल्स वुड गो अवे. हाई सी सेल्स, यू मस्ट बी अवेयर ऑफ द हाई सी सेल ट्रांजैक्शन. फॉलोइंग हाई सी right before, yeah, without accepting the
before landing,
then it can happen after landing also, but before it crosses the customs barrier, before it crosses the customs barrier, in case you are selling those goods before that, the ICS sale transaction allowed, then VAT is not levyable. It is the person who will ultimately take delivery from the customs department, he will pay the customs duty and take the goods. So I think that will still remain outside the purview of the GST because they are not, they cannot tax goods which are outside the border of India, right? So that thing still would continue. One thing which we have been facing, another issue is regarding sales to Bombay High, ONGC. I think there are various controversies whether it is a part of India, it's not a part of India, whether VAT or service tax should be levied on that or not. So in the current scenario there are various issues whether sales or whether VAT should be levied, not levied. We have seen certain tenders of ONGC also where say that all the responsibility is of the seller who is going to sell the goods to ONGC. So again it's always a question of costing, how to bid that tender for ONGC. But I think one clarity which is going to come under the GST is that ONGC will be considered, that Bombay High will be considered to be a part of India, and that they have specified in the GST law, the model draft law. So I think that controversy is going to come to a rest. ITC matching will be there. Those who are well versed with the VAT returns, I don't know how many of you are well versed with the VAT returns, J1, J2 matching, that matching is there. It is not there for excise as of today. I don't know whether 1:1, they are not matching it online. Even for service tax, input credit, they are not matching it online. But here now, what will have to be done, there will be a transaction-wise uploading of information into the system. And that transaction-wise matching of input tax credit by the purchaser will be there. So lots and lots of data is going to go into the system. And it is going to be all across India. That ITC matching is going to be a one big task, and there are going to be monthly returns which will have to be filed by the dealer. Maybe we will come to those more details about it.
These were the proposed GST rates which were recommended by Chief Economic Advisor Arvind Subramanian panel in December 2015. They told that a revenue neutral rate across the goods and services would be 15 to 15.5%, and with that rate for applicable to all goods. See, today gold and silver VAT is only 1%. For some commodities VAT is 5%, which are industrial inputs. For electronic goods, the rates are 12.5% in Maharashtra. Plus, there is an excise. So, if we add up excise, say in the state of Gujarat, there is a 12.5% excise plus 15% VAT. So, the tax applicable to that commodity is 27.5%. Against that, there is a recommendation of 15 to 15.5%. This was the recommendation by the committee that this is the revenue neutral rate. Government will be at par. This rate is come. Again, there are administrative costs which are linked to this. So the standard rate on most goods and services, if to bring this revenue neutral rate, this would be the rate which the government would have to charge. So the standard rate on most goods and services would be 17 to 18%. On essential goods, industrial inputs, etc., 12%. Demerit goods like luxury cars. Luxury cars is a demerit or a merit? I think it's a status symbol for all of us. But it is a demerit goods for the government, and so 40% rate on cars, aerated beverages, pan masala and tobacco products. Even today also they are charged at higher rates, these two items. And beverages also, for I think this beverages like Pepsi and all those, it is 25% is the VAT rate which is applicable. And precious metals they have recommended 1 or 2%. But this is going to be finally given by the GST Council. Now, in the meeting on 3rd of November, soon after Diwali, see 23rd October, 24th October was the GST Council meeting, then 29th, 30th, that was Diwali. On 3rd of November, the Council met again, and these are the rates which have been recommended by the GST Council. 0% tax rate, maybe this will be for essential food items. I think food grains still are non-taxable. India, food, water, flowers, blood. If you see the schedule list, these are still tax-free. Although these are goods, but they are still tax-free. Possibly they will still continue to be tax-free in the GST region. Essential food items and mass consumption items would be 5%. Standard rates across the board would be 12%. Maximum goods and all the services would be at 18%.
and luxury items they were told would be 28%. Rate on gold was not decided in that meeting, so that is still to be decided. Luxury cars, aerated motors, tobacco, which is for the earlier scene, they will tax more than 28%. This was the announcement which had come. And there could be additional cess on goods covered under 28%. Now, why this additional cess? If you see the Swachh Bharat cess, Swachh Bharat cess input tax credit is available? Not available. Is it shared with the state government? It is not shared. And that is again, you see the game of power and the game of money. Old wine in new bottle. Possibly the same thing may come and there could be a cess as recommended by the council just to satisfy the crunch of share of taxes to be governed by the state and the central. Let's see how it comes. We have already discussed what all has come under the Model GST law. We have the 101st Constitutional Amendment Act. The registration process, the registration has already begun, and a state-wise chart has also been given that which states have to get registered by what dates. The refund process, payment process. Excise, VAT and so on. Now, what the government has thought, especially Maharashtra, now the people, the companies who are already registered under excise, they are definitely registered with the VAT department. Right? So, all these excise people, they are registered with the VAT department. So, the VAT department will issue them the provisional user ID and password. Right? So, I think, and if you go to the, now let's understand the process, how it is happening. So, what happens, you have to log in to the through your existing user ID and password of MahaVAT website. Once you log in over there, you get a provisional ID, a user ID and password. With that, you get a provisional registration number. With that provisional registration number, you have to log in to the GST portal. The link takes you over there. Right? After going to the GST portal, you have to mention under which acts you are already registered. So there you can mention that you are already registered under MVAT, CST, Excise, all those acts you can mention. If that is mentioned, I don't think you will be required to again re-register for excise or for service tax.
Right.
That would not be required.
Thank you. Because we have got an ARN number, that is, and we have got the email also. We have successfully migrated, that is from the
state. From this,
Right. So one registration is required and this is a PAN base.
That is PAN base, but that is qua state. So in case if you are having branches in other state, in case if any company is having class, so then it will be qua state. For each state, you will be given a separate registration number.
Thank you.
For
ISD, there is a separate
registration. Yeah, for ISD, there is a separate registration. Yes. Even today, also for ISD, we are having a separate registration number. For ISD, you are having a separate return also under the GST law. Next. These are the various dates which have been announced by the government for various states. It started with Punecheri and Sikkim, Gujarat, Maharashtra. This is the western belt: Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Daman, Diu, Dadra, and Chhattisgarh. 14th November to 29th November. Then Odisha, Jharkhand, Bihar, West Bengal, the central part. Then eastern side, Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya. All this 30th to 15th December. Uttar Pradesh, Jammu, Kashmir, Delhi, Chandigarh, Haryana, Punjab. 16th to 31st of December. Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, 1st January to 15th January. Service tax. So those companies who are having only service providers, pure service provider, not the companies who are having excise VAT and service tax number. Companies who are pure service providers, for them January 1st to 31st of January. And Delta, all registrations, all groups, 1st February to 20th March. So there is one question which is revolving, which still we need to get the clarity on that. What will happen? Say in Maharashtra, we all are based in Maharashtra, the window closes on 29th November. So whether I'll be able to register in the month of December or January or directly on 1st of February. I think that is still not clear whether it would happen. Possibly it appears from the way they have given this chart, the GST council, this chart has come. Possibly the window would get opened again on 1st February. But we need to get some clarification on this count, whether the window would remain open between 29th November to 1st of Feb. From 1st of Feb, definitely it will be available. Some important concepts. Services means anything other than goods. GST, Goods and Services Tax Act. Services ka definition very simple. Jo goods nahi hai, wo services. Anything other than goods is services. Even under the existing service tax law also, it is something similarly, it is defined other than goods. The definition of goods, it is similar to what we have under the Maharashtra Value Added Tax Act, the MVAT Act definition of goods. One change which they have proposed under the GST law is, for the purpose of this clause, the term movable property shall not include any intangible property. The best example is software. So software, as of now, the software companies are charging VAT also, the software companies are charging service tax also. Because both the departments, the state department and the central department, the central government and state government, both of them are trying to charge their taxes on this intangibles, which are deemed sales transactions. Under the article, under the constitution, article 366-29A, there are six items which are deemed sales transactions. One is intangible properties, other is works contract transactions, leasing transactions, restaurants. And these four categories are very clearly stated that these are deemed sales, and hence the government has got right to levy VAT on those transactions. And this has always been the bone of contention, whether on, when you go to a restaurant, are we going for the services or are we going for the food or going for both? So that has always, there are various case laws for and against these arguments, and this has been a bone of contention. Similarly for software, even for leasing, when I am leasing my goods, so should I charge VAT on it or whether I am providing service of giving you the goods? Again, there are various judgments, again both, which go to suggest that either VAT should be levied or service tax should be levied. So the first thing which they have done is, in the definition of goods, they have excluded intangible property. So notified intangibles like patents, trademarks, import license, DPP software, if we are selling a DPP license, we are charging VAT as of today. Software packages, copyrights, design, franchise, etc. They are currently, VAT is payable. So under GST, they will be treated as services and not as goods. So they are trying to put to rest a controversy whether these are goods or these are services. Software will definitely be a service only, and it will be levied by way of service. It will be treated as a supply of service and not a supply of goods under the GST Act. Supply has also been defined in Section 3. I don't think we will go into those details much. Aggregate turnover. Aggregate turnover means the aggregate value of all taxable and non-taxable supplies, exempt supplies and export of goods and or services of a person having the same PAN. to be computed on all India basis and exclude taxes if any charged. So this is going to be again an important term for us to identify that what is going to be my turnover, what is going to be my aggregate turnover. Say today if a company is registered in Maharashtra, if it has to go for a exhibition say in Gujarat, and maybe it's going to have a small turnover. See, we have a mix of people. We have companies who have 100 crores turnovers, 500 crores turnover. There are small traders who are having 1 crore turnover in Maharashtra and 5-10 lakhs turnovers in the other state. Say, so what would happen to such dealers? They are not liable to get registered in the other state because they being below the threshold limit of that state. But now what is going to happen to the 20 lakhs threshold limit which is given? It is on all India basis. So if a Maharashtra mein dealer registered hai aur Gujarat mein 10,000 ka bhi sale kiya to usko registration mandatory ho jata hai. At present it is not required, but under the GST law that person will be required to take a registration number. There is also a concept of casual dealer. Casual taxable person. So in some of the VAT laws, in some states, they have this concept of casual taxable person. West Bengal has this. And if a person comes for a short period of time to the state of West Bengal, then he can register as a casual taxable person, get registration, pay taxes. Now that concept has been brought under the GST for all India. In Maharashtra, that concept is not there as on today. So if a company has to come to Maharashtra for an exhibition, they are facing problem that whether to take a registration, not to take a registration. We have seen some cases that a sales tax officer pohunch jata hai exhibition center mein, aapne kitne ka material becha. You know, so many problems are getting created. So many exhibition halls, exhibition centers are there. They are raiding them. And ultimately revenue is not coming because no sale prove hi nahi ho paata hai. So the concept of casual taxable person will come into place. And it means a person who occasionally undertakes transactions involving supply of goods or services or furtherance of business in the course or furtherance of business, whether as principal, agent or any other capacity in a taxable territory where he has no fixed place of business. I am going to Gujarat for an exhibition. I don't have my office over there. Mera koi site location bhi nahi hai. I am going for the exhibition only. Then I need to register in that state as a casual taxable person. I will get a registration for 90 days. In case if I want to still extend that, I will get another additional 90 days but not more than 180 days. Otherwise, then I have to register as a normal dealer in that state. I have to pay the taxes, estimated taxes in advance in that state and get the registration number. So this will be the provisions for casual taxable person. So this change would come. Works contract transactions. Basically, it is similar to what we are having today also, works contract transaction. But again, a big change. This was one of the deemed sales transactions. And if we see Schedule 3 of the Model GST law, they are now going to treat all these works contract transactions as deemed services and not as deemed sales transactions. So it will be a supply of services. Again, a marked change. Again, an area of controversy and area of litigation. Works contract transactions have always been a bone of contention, whether VAT will be levied or service. We know that in many repairs contracts, construction contracts, both are levied. VAT and service both are being levied as of today. There is reverse charge mechanism also applicable, partial reverse charge also applicable, some have uske andar, right? So again, there is going to be a big conceptual change in the works contract definition, as well as it will be treated as a supply of services and not as supply of goods. Zero rated supply has also been defined. It will mean supply of any goods or services on which no tax is payable, but credit of input tax related to that supply is admissible. So that is, for example, exports. Exports is zero rated. So on export of goods, I will not be liable to pay any tax on my outward supplies. But on all my inward supplies, I will be eligible for the input tax credit. But say if I am selling exempted goods, say I am selling grains, food grains. There are so many big companies also in this food grain arena. They are supplying wheat, pulses, rice, and those food grains are exempted goods. And if I am selling exempted goods, then I am not eligible for the input tax credit. Or rather, there will be a proportionate input tax credit that would be available to me. Say if I am selling exempted goods as well as taxable goods. then I will not be eligible for the full input tax credit. It will be a proportional credit rate which will be available. Even today we have similar provisions for proportional credit. Yeah? Captive consumption.
You have. Yeah.
Sir, my government.
Input credit there.
So today also, I think you will get an input credit of that. For your captive consumption, there will be, it will not be treated as a supply which is taxable because you are not selling it to any other person. It is within your company only. It is within your premises. So it would not be liable to tax on your output side. Whatever input credit is available to you would be available. I don't think that there will be any denial of that. I didn't find any such provision which would deny input tax credit on captive consumption. So that would be available. Concept is there under the GST law.
Okay.
So, but rules have not yet been prescribed. Possibly it will come. So, we have to wait for the rules for that. Yeah, it will be there. There are provisions, but how exactly it is going to come, that will be clarified after the exact rules come.
Sir,
under
this model GST,
reverse
charge mechanism is only for imports, right?
No, it is for goods. It is only for imports. For services, it is there. I think section 7 of the GST law defines that on particular transactions. Yeah, on those transactions reverse charge is there. On which transactions it will come, but they are not prescribed in rules. It says that as may be prescribed. You can see that. I'll just read section 7, subsection 3.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It is, section 7 is regarding levy and collection of CGST and SGST. Subsection 3. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 2, the central or state government may, on the recommendation of the council, by notification, specify categories of supply of goods and or services, the tax on which is payable on reverse charge basis. And the tax thereon shall be paid by the person receiving such goods and or services, and all the provisions of this act shall apply.
But it is not defined as which are the services.
That is not prescribed. It will prescribe. And that is what I told you. There are at least 100, more than 150 places where they are telling that they will prescribe the rules and the categories of the specified persons who will be liable to pay tax. e-commerce. This is the big thing again. E-commerce is capturing everybody's attention. We ourselves will be buying so many things on Flipkart and Amazon and all such things. Only one new concept has come under e-commerce, and that is the TCS, tax collection at source. We have TCS under income tax. Say on sale of scrap, we are charging 1% TCS and we are collecting it. So here what would happen in this case, say there is a person who is a company, say ABC and company is selling its mobile on Flipkart, right? And we as consumer are purchasing it. So what happens, we select the product, we place the order, we make payment to Flipkart. Flipkart intimates to that company, ABC and company, you please deliver this product to the end customer who wants the product, and we get the delivery of that. How does the billing happen? That billing happens from Flipkart to the end customer. Right? It happens directly from here at WS, wholesale, retail, those, if you have seen those bills, it comes from those companies. But the payment goes to Flipkart. Now, a new provision has come under the GST that for all such transactions which are routed through an e-commerce portal, the person who is receiving the money will have the liability to pay TCS of the person who is supplying the goods to the end consumer. So in this example, Flipkart will have to deduct TCS on payments when it makes payments to ABC and company, in our case ABC mobile company. And like TDS credit that we get under income tax, the TCS credit will be available to ABC and company when ABC and company is going to file its return. So that is one new concept which has come under this. And this is more to catch in the unorganized sector, because huge sales are happening through e-commerce portals and very few dealers are registered under VAT or excise who are selling the products through such companies. And that is how the government is going to widen the tax base net. TCS kata to usko credit to aane hi wala hai. Usko that PAN has to get registered. Now the sale is happening directly. The government does not come to know ki kitna sale hua hai. How to track it? And I think this is a brilliant idea that they have brought about this TCS on such companies. Then of course there are provisions like filing of TCS returns, getting of TCS credit by that company, all those provisions are available. Composition scheme. This composition scheme has come for small dealers having turnover less than 50 lakhs in a year. So it is applicable only to small dealers. The composition amount will not be less than 1%. So it is minimum 1%. How to compute that turnover? It will be the aggregate value of all taxable and non-taxable supplies, exempt supplies and exports of goods and or services on all India basis excluding GST. So, if a person is providing services worth 20 lakhs and sale of goods worth 40 lakhs rupees, so his turnover exceeds 50 lakhs rupees, so that person will not be eligible for the composition scheme of 1%. Right? So, his turnover of goods as well as services on all India basis is to be considered for computing this 50 lakh. That person is not going to get any input tax credit. सबको लगे अरे यार 1% है तो अच्छा है, मैं वो वही करता हूँ, 18% क्यों बोलूँ. बट वॉट वुड हैपन वेन दिस कंपोजिशन डीलर से अगेन एबीसीएल कंपनी, एबीसीएल कंपनी ऑफ्स फॉर कंपोजिशन, इफ इट बाइज गुड्स इट विल हैव टू पे जीएसटी ऑन दैट, 18% जीएसटी पे करे बट उसको क्रेडिट नहीं मिलेगा. एंड ऑन इट सेल्स साइड इट विल चार्ज 1%. द पर्सन हु परचेजेस फ्रॉम दिस डीलर्स दे विल नॉट बी एबल टू गेट द इनपुट क्रेडिट ऑफ दिस 1% ऑल्सो. But the company will have to pay that amount to the government. It cannot collect the tax separately. Right? So government ko to 18% pehle mil gaya. Plus ye 1%, 2% jo aayega wo additional milne wala hai. So it is not that it is easy, going to be easy. But only thing for small dealers, if they don't want to go through the hassles of maintaining all those details, this scheme is available. Secondly, koi bolega, are, why should I buy from registered dealer? Main unregistered dealer se purchase karunga. Indians are, you know, 50-50 लाख के 4-5 कंपनी बना देता हूँ, सब यूआईडी परचेस करूंगा. देन देयर इज अ टैक्स पेमेंट अंडर रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म फॉर यूआईडी परचेसेस. for composition dealers only. Now this has not come in the model GST law, but in one of the FAQs which have been issued by the government, by the CBEC, one of the FAQs contains is that if you buy goods, if the composition dealer buys goods from an unregistered dealer, he will have to pay his GST on reverse charge mechanism. So ultimately 18% government ko milna hi hai, plus composition ka 1%. So this loophole also they have tried to plug in right away. That, see, we are seeing so many loopholes being plugged with demonetization and the things coming in, and trying to plug the loophole at every point as and when the government is getting the information. So here lots of planning is happening on the government side. They are very ahead, very much ahead of us. GST cannot be collected separately. And no interstate. Such dealers cannot have interstate supplies also. They cannot buy, say, a dealer IGST. They cannot have purchases of IGST and then claim the credit. So all sorts of restrictions are there for such composition dealers. Next. Migration of existing taxpayers. I should compliment the persons who already enrolled and registered for GST. So it's a good beginning. You are well ahead of the curve, getting yourself geared up and prepared for the upcoming GST. So a provisional certificate will be issued. We have already discussed that provisional registration will be given. This will be valid for a period of 6 months from the date of its issue, provided that the date may be extended for a further period, government has a power. And within the period specified, whatever documents are required, address proof, director's details, photograph, etc., all those details are required to be uploaded, scanned. There is some file size also, 1 MB, 100 KB, etc. There are various sizes which are given, that your scanned image should be of that size only. So all those documents will have to be submitted on the website. This is one more point in this. This is in case of new registrations. Any dealer, if a new company is being set up, then what are the provisions? Such person should get registered within 30 days from which that person is liable to pay tax. A person having multiple business verticals in the state may obtain separate registration for each business vertical in the state. Now, what does that mean? Under excise today, we are having the concept of separate registrations for each location. Under MVAT, we are having one single registration for the entire state of Maharashtra. For some PSI units earlier, there was a provision of having a separate VAT registration which was thereafter discontinued, and now they are having separate forms 231 and 234 under VAT which they are filing. So what happens under GST? Under GST, for all your locations within the state of Maharashtra, there will be one single GST PIN number for the state of Maharashtra. But in case if your company is dealing in separate business verticals, for example, let's take Godrej. Godrej is dealing in consumer products, Godrej is dealing in furniture. Say if it is maintaining separate business segments as defined under AS 17, Accounting Standard 17 issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants, by ICA, and you are reporting segment reporting in that manner, if you are reporting in your financials, your final financials, then you have the option of getting separate GST registration within the state for that segment, right? So for example, we can take one more example. Say you are having, take the example of Godrej. Godrej is having, say, a division at Mumbai and at Nasik for consumer products, plus two more divisions, say Pune and Aurangabad for furniture division, say. So for Mumbai and Nasik, the consumer division, it has to have one number, it cannot have a separate number. For business vertical, which is a separate vertical, in the example which I gave, Pune and Aurangabad, it can have a separate registration number for that. But it's an option which is available, and it is for the segment only. I think that we need to remember, because that is going to be a shift major change. One thing is the excise registration, which is going to get discontinued for each location, and other is this business vertical.
This limits we can go ahead with.
This is for a new registration. I think we can skip this. It will be a PAN based registration. A single window and registration will be given in within 3 working days. That is what the government is. Written something? I think the see, what one is ease of doing business and maintaining records. See, if you are you will be having a clear cut data for filing the returns for your separate segment. If you have the data, you need not merge into one and file a single return. I think that is one, that is managing the data is one advantage. Second is flow of input credit. Say if you don't want to transfer your credit from one unit to another, or maybe you know that okay, this kind of purchases are for this segment and this kind of purchases are for the other business segment, you can have a segregation of that. Apart from that, we also have the concept of input service distributor as we have under the existing service tax law. So that is also available. So in case you want to register as an ISP, you can register it for that separately, and there are returns and procedures for that also. And service that, but it is ISP is only for the services and not for the inputs. So maybe there we may have to plan out that where is the flow of material happening. If it is really worth that all materials, generally materials would flow in that particular segment only. I don't think the purchases which are required for a furniture division would flow into the consumer products division. So that would not happen. I think that is only ease of doing business and compilation of data. That is what I feel is the major advantage. Disadvantage is you have to file returns for both, registration for both. That is the disadvantage. If you feel that the compliance would increase to that extent. So that is that a call the company will have to take whether what they want to do. Return, these are the returns which the companies will have to file. I'll start from here. Periodical returns. GST R 1 will be for outward supplies. GST R 2 for inward supplies. And GST R 3 will be the monthly return. So by 10th of the end of the month, say for the month of April, 10th of May. 10th May the outward supplies data has to be uploaded. By 15th, the inward supplies data has to be uploaded. And by 20th, 3 more dates you have to remember. By 20th, the challan payment and the uploading of the monthly return will have to be done. So now, what would happen? So how this is going to happen? Basically, everything will be system oriented. As we saw earlier, all the transactions will have to be first uploaded. So, jitne bhi sales hai, outward liability, tax jis pe bharna hai, wo sab data pura sab server mein chala jayega. Right? Sale hoga, service provide hoga, uske baad hi purchase hoga na. Uske pehle to ho hi nahi sakta hai. So input credit, what would happen? Once the suppliers, they upload their sales data, all their sales transactions, their provision of service transactions, when the person, he wants, the person, say the other person, for his purchases or for his inward supplies, when he will go to file the returns, all the data will get auto-populated into his return of inward supplies. That you have purchased from this 10 parties, and from this 10 parties, these are the bills, these are the transactions on which credit is available to you. So this will be one task which the taxation team will have to undergo, that manage itna purchase kiya hai, the purchase which I have booked, whether I have got the credit of it or not. Samne wale ne supply dikhaya hai ki nahi, whether the seller, the supplier has shown his supplies in the output. If he is not showing it in his output supplies, the person receiving or booking it will not get the credit thereof.
One question.
Yeah.
On inward, suppose on inward supplies.
The goods are not received to us, but what happens is the goods are not received to us.
On 29, 20, or on the first or second, we receive the goods.
Right.
What happens in that case?
Yeah, so if you are booking your goods, say the seller has sold goods on 29th of April,
yeah,
and you have received your goods on 2nd of May, the month changes, right? That is your question. And you will be booking your purchases on 2nd of May. So what would happen? Whether that credit will get lost? No, that credit will remain in your IGST ledger. So in the month, for the month of May, when you will book your purchases, it will get matched with the purchases which come from the earlier month, and that record would continue for all the months, for all the 12 months that record would continue. These are the purchases which the these are the transactions which your seller or your supplier has shown in your account.
And filing the returns. That means do we have to show those transactions?
No.
Yeah, but then is the supplier has already shown.
Right. So there you will be having a window that okay, these are the purchases which I am booking with my accounts. Right? See, there could be a situation, there could be an error also. Manas matra bhulne patra. Right? So there could be errors also that somebody might put your GST pin by error and he may show that he has sold the goods to you. Actually you have not purchased those goods. So will you take the credit of that? You are not going to take the credit. Are you going to book that purchases? No, you are not going to book that purchases. Are you going to make payment to that person? You are not going to make payment to that person. So there is a provision that you will have to accept out of the inward supplies. And okay, these are the supplies which I accept, and these are still these 5 transactions are there which I have received the bills, but the supplier is not shown in his outward supplies. So I want to claim that. So that will go under your provisional input tax credit. It will remain as a provision. A 2 months window will be given, time frame will be given of 2 months. You will have to communicate with your vendor that I have purchased the goods, I am having an invoice, why you have not shown in your outward supplies. Payment nahi dunga tab tak. Right? Koi hone wala hai, tab tak payment nahi dunga. And then you will be able to monitor, okay, you show the supplies, and then when you file the subsequent month return, that would get again auto-populated in the system where he will upload it. And that is how the credit would be matched and followed. This would also be the case for debit notes, credit notes, everything. Now taking the case of a credit note. So what would happen in the case of credit notes? Say I have sold goods worth rupees, we have sold goods worth rupees 1 lakh to a certain person and charged 18% GST on it. So 1,18,000. Then that fellow says no, I want a discount. This rate is not correct. I wanted 90,000 only. So 10,000 is say the rate difference. Right? So we issue a credit note. Okay, we will issue a credit note. Now unless and until the credit note, the person issuing the credit note reflects in his GSTR 3, unless that credit note is reflected, the person will not get the credit of that. Of the debit which he will be mentioning in his GSTR 2, right? Like matching of the sales with the purchases, the debit note of one person is the credit note of the other person. So unless the person who is issuing the credit note reduces this tax liability, the person who has to reduce his input tax credit will not be able to do that, right? So it will be again matched. The entire processes will be given. They have given also the entire processes. We have to go through those processes. But there is a mechanism of ITC matching for such dealers that all the invoices and all the debit credit notes will be matched. If other person is giving that effects, the credit will be given, otherwise it will not be given. Only one issue which I see over here and which we have already represented before the state finance ministers. You might be knowing that in J1, J2 in VAT, that Hawala scam has taken, and there are so many dealers who have not paid the VAT. Section 48.5, some of you might have received the notices or you might have heard about it. So what is section 48(5) of the Ambit Act says that unless the person has paid the taxes into the government treasury, the credit thereof will not be available to the purchaser of those goods. So unless the seller pays the tax, the credit thereof will not be available to the purchaser. And there was a judgment of Mahalakshmi Cottons Engineering, right, in that context. And based on that, there are certain observations. Department has been abruptly disallowing credit in all cases wherever there is a Hawala dealer, J1, J2 mismatch under the VAT arena. Whether it is right, whether it is correct, incorrect, there is again a matter of litigation which is going on in numerous cases. And recently the Maharashtra Settlement of Disputes Act is also, it is still going on, the amnesty under the Ambit Act for whatever appeals are filed, it is still going on as a measure of that, to do away with the litigation in that arena. So that amnesty scheme is going on and many people are either withdrawing their cases, paying taxes under amnesty, and all those things are happening. So the matter is that if I made genuine purchase, I have not made hawala purchase. Hawala hai toh theek hai, we can understand. The purchaser also knows that he has made hawala purchases. But in case you have made a genuine purchase and the other person is defaulting in paying his taxes, then why should I suffer? I am having a valid tax invoice. I have paid my payment to that person. Then why should I be disallowed the credit? I think that is, but that provision has come under the GST law also, which is there in the Maharashtra Act. And I think that is one provision which the industry should also object to. We already as association have given our representation that such a provision should be removed. If I am having a valid tax invoice, then that is the document on which I am relying. There is always a declaration on every invoice. I thereby certify that my registration under the Ambit Act is in force and I will pay the taxes due thereon. And that is to suffice that, okay, the other person is going to pay the tax. I cannot go and catch all that person with whom you tax him bara jaake work. It is not possible. It is the government which has the machinery to do it. As an individual, as a company, I don't have that power or that machinery to do that, nor am I authorized to do it. I say jaake bolunga paisa nahi bharega, so that is a separate part. But as a company, I don't have a machinery to catch hold of that person. But that provision has creeped into the GST law also. And I think that is one provision which should not come under the GST law. The basis should be the tax invoice, that I have got the tax invoice. Based on this tax invoice, I made the payment and I have got the delivery of the goods, and I should be given the credit. So that is one bit of worry under the GST law, because now what is happening? This J1J2 mismatch, 48(5), section 48(5) mismatch was under Maharashtra. Now this is going to be all India. मैं कहीं झारखंड से परचेस करूंगा, गुवाहाटी से परचेस करूंगा, आसाम में कहां से भी परचेस करूंगा. सो दैट पर्सन वो कितना एजुकेटेड है मुझे मालूम नहीं है. सो वेदर ही विल अपलोड इट इनटू द सिस्टम और नॉट, व्हाट इफ देयर आर एरर्स इन दैट सिस्टम इन अपलोडिंग, उसका कुछ गलती हो गया, उसने गलत टीन नंबर डाल दिया तो क्या. आई थिंक ऑल दोस रिकंसिलिएशन पार्ट इज गोइंग टू बी अ वर्क दैट वी विल हैव टू अंडरगो व्हाइल फाइलिंग ईच ऑफ दिस रिटर्न्स. दैट थिंग इज गोइंग टू बी देयर.
One more thing I just missed out. I'll come to it. There's one more point in this.
That is what. Yeah, rating. Yeah, so there is a rating of the dealers also which has which will be coming under the GST law. Like we have when we invest in deposits, AAA rating here, so this is a good fixed deposit company, right? So like there will be a rating 3-star, 4-star, 5-star of the dealers who are regular in complying the GST law and regular in paying the taxes. So they will come out with the criteria. As of now, they have come out only with the provision that such a rating system for each dealer is going to come. And based on that rating system, you can decide, your company can decide whether you want to work with a 5-star rated company or a 0-star rated company. Right? So that is one good additional feature. This rating feature has also come in under GST law. Then there are GST 4, 5, 6, 7, these are for the TCS returns, casual dealer, non-resident dealer, those returns are there. For normal, all the dealers, the returns will be monthly. So now instead of filing a excise return, VAT return, service tax return, we will not have to file a separate CGST, SGST, IGST return. The return will be one, but it will contain sales, purchase and final liability. Then we will also have like a ITC ledger, ITC cash ledger, ITC credit ledger. That ledgers will also be there. It will be available, okay, against this purchase, so much credit is available to you. So all those provisions are going to come. And apart from that, there will be an annual return which is to be filed by the end of the year along with the audit report. I think for that a special provision will have to come. As of in the model GST law, that provision is not there. No such provision is appearing as of today. It is the industry's demand that that has to come. What we are hearing that even for that IGST for stock transfer, in the meeting which we had with one of the few of the officers, they told that it was the industry's demand that they want IGST on the stock transfers also, so that there is a free flow of credit. Now, if all these exemptions are to discontinue, right, then only the GST rate will be, we will get an effective GST. But if the same exemptions are going to continue, then the GST rate will still be higher. So, फिर से वो 27-28% पे चला जाएगा, the standard rate instead of the 18%. But one point is that if your deferment scheme or exemption scheme, you have been promised that this is your 10-year window and maybe it is still 2020, it is applicable. So what would be in those cases is still going to be a case of concern. We have to wait and watch how the government is going to come out with that. Because many companies have set up their companies in Baddi, in Diu, Daman, in so many MIDCs in various regions, in backward, and they are claiming those benefits. And if that period has not expired, can the government, which had promised earlier that you will be given a window of 10 years for your exemption or for your deferral, that will suddenly get cut off? I think the government cannot do that. They will have to come out with some provision. But today there is no clarity on that part. In this, we have already taken up ITC matching. Proportionate ITC, I think I have got many things to share and tell you, but I think it's almost lunch time and it's 1:15 already. I'll just give the concept. In case you are having taxable as well as non-taxable supplies, then the input tax credit of which you are eligible will be given a proportionate credit and will not be allowed full credit. Because ultimately, the government is not going to give you from its pocket. Because sales side taxable hai, toh purchases ka exemption milne wala hai. Even VAT laws also, it is similar. Even the wage tax, those companies which are providing taxable as well as exempted services, for them also proportionate credit is available. So that scenario is going to continue under the GST regime also. Capital goods. Previous one. Under the excise law today, we are eligible for tax credit on purchases of capital goods. 50% is eligible in the first year, 50% in the next year. But here, entire credit will be available in the first year itself. So that is going to be a change under the GST law. In the first year, entire credit. See, under MBAT, we are getting set off in the first year itself. But not under excise. Again, this is a combination. It must khichdi hai, masala khichdi hai ye. VAT, service tax or excise ka. Right? So, at least one good thing is that for capital goods, is available. Question is that whether capital goods will be also be liable for proportionate ITC. If you are selling exempted as well as taxable. We were trying to do an analysis for a company. They are selling exempted goods. And they are processing, it's a dal mill, and on the sales side, their liability is nil. So, what we are getting as a project for the capital goods also, their setup will become proportionate. And if they are selling exempted goods, the setup will get washed away. They will not get the full credit. So, that is what. Personal expenses disallowed for IT purpose, whether it will be subject to proportionate disallowance. As you know, under income tax in the current year, in 16-17, there is an amendment that in case the use of motor car, that is the best example that we can have, that motor car is used for office use as well as for personal use. And many companies, Roha Moto, they claim that, okay, out of this total motor car expenses, say 20%, I am disallowing, I am not claiming my expenses. Or in scrutiny, the income tax officer will disallow. So on such disallowance for personal expense, so if any asset is put to a personal use, the set off will be disallowed proportionately. Now the question comes here that while filing your GST return, you have claimed full set off of your motor car expenses. In income tax, the officer, the scrutiny comes, and while filing your tax, auditor says, no, you will have to disallow 20% proportionately. Right? So what would happen? Why is the officer disallowing the income tax law? Because of the personal nature, because of the amendment that has come in the Income Tax Act, also there is an amendment. Right? So there is a proportionate disallowance. So if the GST adjudicating authority calls for those records and says, okay, for this motor car, what treatment you have given under income tax? Achha, usko proportionate disallowance hone wala hai. So why not here? Right? So those questions would come, and that planning would have to be done at the initial stage. Because your GST is set off, you will be calculating on monthly basis. IT return to March khatam hoga, agle September mein tax audit hoga. Tabhi wo auditor aayega, bolega ye proportionate disallow karna hai expenses ya nahi karna hai. So if we have to allow or disallow any such personal use of assets or personal expenses, that can be taken while claiming the ITC at that point of time itself. Anyway, the ITC on motor vehicles used for business purposes is only allowed. Other cases, it is not allowed. I think we should move ahead because there's not much time. ITC conditions, I think this is important. Input tax credit shall not be eligible unless the is in possession of a tax invoice, debit note, supplementary invoice, or such other prescribed document issued by a supplier registered under the under this Act or the IGST Act. So, unless you have the tax invoice or the debit note, the supplementary invoice will be issued in cases of IGST. In the case of ISD distribution, Input Service Distributor, to provide the credit to the other person, he will have to issue a supplementary invoice for transferring the credit from its one unit to its another unit. For that, it will be available. Unless he has received the goods or services. So this is a very obnoxious provision. How to prove that the goods have been received, or how to prove that services have been received? Right? For a big company, those who are maintaining a GRN register and all those systems are in place, this will not be much of an issue. But for small dealers, small traders, small service providers, this is going to be a big issue. How will you prove that the goods are received? Say you are going to buy a mobile. Is he going to give you a delivery challan or an alarm? What proof will you have? Only the invoice will be there. You have paid the cash, or now not cash, credit card. You have paid through credit card and you have received the mobile and the invoice. That is it. So how will you prove that you have received the goods? This is again a very stringent provision that this has to be there. But now, what would happen? The LR, the lorry receipt, say for the companies, LR was not a compulsory document under the VAT laws. You have to maintain the LR as a proof of received, of that you have received the goods. And for CST transactions, to prove that your transactions are interstate transactions, the LR is required to match that, okay, you have supplied the goods from one state to another. People are maintaining. For purchases, chalta tha, kabhi hai, nahi hai. But here, to claim the input tax credit, you have to keep that LR copy. Documentation will increase the way those goods are received in my factory premises or in my godown. This is that the provision, the tax charge in respect of such supply is paid to the credit of the appropriate government, either in cash or through credit. So unless the other person pays the tax, the person purchasing the goods will not get the credit. And unless he has filed the return. So for unregistered dealers, if a dealer is not getting a registration number, he will not be able to claim the input tax credit. So he has to file the return to claim the input tax credit. if you remain unregistered and the there is a search or a, and that person has not taken a registration number, even though he might have paid GST on his purchases and then sold the goods, he will not be eligible for the input tax credit. It will be a double whammy for that person. Time limit, shall not be able to take in respect of goods after filing the return under section 27 for the month of September. So for these goods, whatever purchases you are making, to claim the credit, they have to be booked before, say for financial year 17-18, by 30th September 2018, you will have to claim the input tax credit, otherwise you will not be able to claim the input tax credit at all. Again, everything will be system oriented. Ek saal juna bill nahi chalega. एक साल जुड़ा चलेगा, ओल्ड बिल चलेगा एक साल पहले का, लेकिन अप्रैल का बिल यू कैन बुक इन द नेक्स्ट अप्रैल, बट जो मार्च का बिल है इट हैज टू कम बाय सितंबर एंड यू टू क्लेम इट बाय सितंबर और बिफोर फाइलिंग योर एनुअल रिटर्न. इफ यू आर फाइलिंग, से इफ योर डेटा इज वेरी परफेक्ट, यू आर कंप्लीटेड योर एनुअल रिटर्न, एनुअल ऑडिट भी हो गया है और जून में फाइल कर दिया, देन यू कैन नॉट क्लेम इट आफ्टर दैट, राइट? सो दैट इज अदर प्रोविजन व्हिच वी नीड टू टेक केयर ऑफ. ITC refund. If there is excess input tax credit available to me, say on my sales side I have a liability of 1 lakh rupees and on the purchase side I have input tax credit of 1,50,000. So 50,000 is excess. So whether this 50,000 rupees I have to claim as refund in cash from the government, whether I am allowed to claim it or whether I have to carry it forward. Carry it forward. So under service tax, are we getting a refund? We are getting a refund only if we export the services. Otherwise, in case of services provided within India, we don't get a refund. We get a credit which can be carried forward and adjusted in our against our subsequent tax liability. Are we getting a refund under excise? Only in case of exports. Otherwise. This getting accumulated. Cash refund नहीं आता है, नहीं आता है, right? Under VAT, VAT में refund आता है. VAT has a provision. So there are three different tax. VAT we can claim a cash refund. Under service tax and excise we can claim only if the goods are exported or the services are exported out of the country. Right? Sir, any doubt? So, under GST also there is no refund except in the case of export. Whatever accumulated credit is there, keep on carrying it forward. That is why that planning is required. That how much credit is going to get accumulated? How, where should my depot be? Whether should I make it a branch transfer or should I make an interstate sale or should I have a consignment agent? That is going to be. Achha, one more thing regarding consignment agent, I think that we have not covered. Consignment agent today. Under VAT, if I have a consignment agent in the other state, I can transfer the goods to that consignment agent against Form F, like my branch transfer. But again, under GST scenario, this Form F for consignment transactions will not be applicable. So there I have to charge IGST and that person will have to sell it for good. Second, even within the state, say within Maharashtra, I am having a consignment agent and I am transferring the goods to the consignment. Today, there is no tax applicable to that, but under GST it will become taxable. If I am transferring it to my own branch, it is not taxable. But if I am transferring to a consignment agent, it is becoming taxable. So the scenario is changing in case of consignment agents also. ITC on job work, I think this we have already taken up earlier. Transitional provisions, there are various transitional provisions also. Whatever input tax credit will be available as per the return file of excise, service tax and VAT. Again, we have to see all the three scenarios. So whatever input tax credit will be available as on 31st March 2017, that will be eligible for being carried forward under the GST Act. Right? So those transitional provisions have been put into place even for the capital goods on which, say you have bought the capital goods machinery in 16-17, 50% अभी क्लेम किया है, 50% नेक्स्ट ईयर में आप अवेल करने वाले हैं, सो दैट विल बी अवेलेबल अंडर द जीएसटी सिनेरियो आल्सो. That we have to see how it will come under which that is not clear. Yeah, right. So whether it will come under IGST or SGST, because if it is IGST, you can claim credit across, but otherwise you will not be able to. So I think that one point we need to check out whether how that credit will be available. But principally, it will be available. Whether IGST or CGST is one question, but it will be available. But one more clause which they have inserted over here and which I feel is incorrect. The taxable person shall be entitled to credit only when ITC or surcharge were admissible under the earlier law, that is under excise if it was admissible, and is also admissible under GST. So how will I know today in 2016-17 when I am making certain expenses on which I am claiming ITC today, I am doing it on the rules applicable today. I don't know what is going to come under GST. So this clause again we have represented before the finance minister, state finance minister, that this clause, this part from year to year should be omitted under the GST law. Let's hope it does get omitted. But this is one thing which is disturbing, that it cannot be governed by the new law. Whatever was under the old law should be applicable to the old law, and whatever is applicable under the new law should be applicable to the new law. Capital goods we have seen. Transformation. So now having got a glimpse of what GST is going to be, maybe what I have explained to you all is maybe just a tip of the iceberg. There are so many things that would be coming in. But what should we do now? How we should go forward? What should be our way forward? So the transformation process will be changes in the basic understanding of indirect taxes. The concept of manufacture and sale has to be done away with. The concept of supply will set in. The compliances will change. Instead of excise return, VAT return, service tax return, there will be a GST return which will consist of outward supplies, inward supplies and a monthly return. So that would change. The ITC claiming processes would change. The audit and the assessment procedures would also change. Tax accounting. Here, again, we have to, when we register in the new portal, we have to put the HSN code for each of the commodities, right? You might have put in. And for the services accounting code also has to be mentioned in case if you are having any services. So that would happen. In our softwares, in our entire, whatever ERP we be using, Tally or whatever software we are using, that software will have to be get amended, changed. The duties and taxes heading that we are having now will undergo a change under the GST arena. So that changes will have to bring into our software. The accounting team, the procurement team, the supply team, they also will have to be given this understanding of how this data has to be punched into the new system with the new law. The supply chain, We will have to revisit the supply chain. The sourcing strategy versus whether we have to make or buy. Should we do the manufacturing or should we directly import? What will be easier? What will be better? Where will the margins be? The distribution strategy between stock transfer or depot versus distributor and dealer. That will have to be revisited. That will have to be recalculated in this new scenario. The sourcing pattern, availability of increased credit to vendors for services like renting of immovable property. Let's take the example of shops in the mall. Say there are so many malls coming up. Now, today service tax is applicable on renting of immovable property. So on all these shops, the shop owner is charging service tax. On this service tax, the vendor in the shop is selling the goods, is not getting credit. Wo VAT laga raha hai. So purchase input side mein service tax hai, output mein right, so no setup. Now we will be eligible for the setup. Right. So in our scenario, we also have to see whether, say, if it's a trading company and they are hiring a godown for their stock purposes. That trading company, say it's not a manufacturer, it's only a trading company. So there also that input credit will be available for stocking those goods on that rent service tax which is paid on the renting, today it is not available, in future it will be available. And that is where the benefits will lie. So that again needs to be checked on case to case basis. Capital expenditure, as we saw, full 100% credit will be available in the first year. So again, a costing factor, when to buy, impact on margin and thereby the selling price, IGST, no retention. Yeah, this is one point which I had not taken earlier. No retention. Branch transfer, which we saw earlier, on branch transfer against Form F, there is a retention of 4% VAT on the purchase side. So that 4% retention will now not be there. So saving of 4% on the branch transfer, that reversal that we were doing on our purchases, that reversal of input tax credit will not be made, so that more set off will be available on the branch transfers. Sales in transit to be done away with, I think that we already considered. And impact on works contract, EPC, maintenance contract, subject to dual taxes. Especially those companies, those which are contracting companies, they will have to relook to the contracts, because the contracts are not going to be. There could be a contract for building a building, a dam, a tunnel, so many contracts are there. And those are periods of long gestation. So what is going to happen to those contracts? What is going to be my impact on my procurement cost and my output liability? Whether the same rate of tax would continue on my existing contract? When I have entered into a contract in 2015 and to construct a road, that contract will get completed in 2018. So part of the contract is in VAT era, part is in the GST era. So what is going to be the impact on my outward tax liability and my input set of liability? When the VAT was brought into 2005, in Maharashtra VAT there is a specific section 96(1)(g) is there in Maharashtra, which is the saving clause, which says that the liability of the contractor under the erstwhile Works Contract Act would not be more than the liability under the VAT Act. So his liability gets restricted. But we did not find any such provision under the GST law. So that saving clause is not there. So whether it will come, so again for this, representations have been made to the government. If such a clause comes in, yes, that will be good. Otherwise, they will have to rework their liabilities. And also whatever contracts which we will be entering into the next 3-4 months, we will have to consider the GST impact, because those transactions may happen in the GST era, and we may have to enter into a contract with our suppliers, with our customers now in this December to March period. So I think that also impact we will have to understand. One more transitional impact which we need to understand is what will happen to the invoices of March. Sir had a question ki bhai 29th April ko purchase kiya hai, 2nd May ko invoice book kiya. Right, in the earlier example. So that was in the GST arena, that point we discussed under the GST scenario. What will happen to the current scenario? 29th March ka invoice hai, 2nd April ko book karenge to kya hoga? VAT ka setup milega? Excise ka setup milega kya? I doubt. Because there is no such provision. Aap baad mein excise return to file karne hi wale nahi hai. So I think this is one thing which the companies will have to understand, a cut-off line. Most of the companies are having a cut-off date in March. Many companies cut off or by 25th March, 21st March, whatever they have their dates. That this will, so will India come to a halt? Standstill pe aa jayega kya India? We don't know. But I think that planning will also have to be done. What is going to happen to such invoices? Because many companies have their policies that okay, only after I receive the goods, it is checked by my quality control department, it is authorized by them, then only I will book it in my purchase, otherwise I will not book them. So I think that also some planning will have to be done in those aspects, that how we are going to take care of those year-end situation, the transition situation. Maybe still more clarity will come on this, but as of now, they have not come out with any solution for this, that what will happen to the year-end invoices. According to me, whatever invoices are there, we have to book in the month of March only, the provision as it appears as on today. And it is better to book it in March only. Jo bhi set off lena hai, VAT, excise, service tax, March mein hi le lo. Again, service tax, reverse charge, usne March ka bill diya, maintenance ka, maine April mein payment kiya, to kya hoga? I think those are still certain questions which for which we will require more clarification, maybe one more seminar like this, and to understand the intricacies of the transitions that are going to happen. We don't know as of today how that is going to happen. But these are some thoughts that we'll have to. And plan your contracts, that is static risk we already done. Understanding the law, planning your contracts, input credit, supply chain, costing and pricing will change. Implement, how to implement? IT optimization, your infrastructure, information technology will have to be upgraded. Whatever SAP, ERP, whatever system, I think they might already have contacted you that GST is coming, so we will change your systems or what. But that will training at all levels would be required. Right? To your sales personnel, to your procurement team, to your accounting team, and the taxation team. So all this training will be there, registration of course will be there, and the documentation monitoring. And what will be the documents required under the new scenario? Maybe some new system we may have to implement to say if you are not keeping track of the inward delivery challans till now. If under GST, if it is going to be required to be maintained, then set up a system for maintaining that. Well, friends, I think this is what I had in my mind that I should share with you on the proposed GST regime. I thank you, all of you, for